Day 5.
Nope.
Just finished the last review when I discovered my supply of mint was almost gone. Went for the emergency supply, only to find it empty.
What the hell?
Okay, a little trade secret. I like mint. It helps me focus mentally. If I'm playing something dull or tedious, it helps me get through it. That and caffeine, but I try not to take too much of that. You know, health reasons. So, what was I playing that used up all my reserves?
God damn, I've been playing for 10 hours, I'm only on the second chapter, and I have no idea what's going on in this game anymore.
Oh. Right. Last time I was here, I shared a few of my favorite multiplayer Half-Life 1 mods, but I also wanted to talk about the single-player ones. There were really only three that I felt were noteworthy, but I didn't want to mix them in with the multiplayer mods in one giant episode. So first up, Redemption. The mod.
This was the first Half-Life single-player mod that really caught my attention back in the day, and apparently Valve liked it too because it was included on the Half-Life Counter-Strike retail disc. Redemption is an example of a common thread you find in most single-player mods and level packs, namely attempting to create the sequel before the actual game makers can. If I tried to explain the plot of this mod, you'd go cross-eyed and start to drool, so to keep it simple, the G-Man has hired Gordon to catch a trio of alien butterflies scattered across the world so they can close a dimensional rift. No, really. Feel free to pause the video if you need a minute for your brain to stop hurting. So the player pilots Gordon as he hunts down these butterflies, called Telmorps, in various locations. A snowy mountain monastery filled with Black Ops assassins, a Zen-themed carnival, and a weapon dealer's private warehouse, before setting them free in Zen. Because we all wanted more Zen levels, didn't we? Aside from the sheer what-the-fuckery, the mod isn't anything to write home about. It's extremely difficult, not from the enemies, but just figuring out where you're supposed to go. The levels are unique, but extremely blocky, and the layout can be very confusing. I don't recommend bothering with this unless you want to hear a half-decent G-Man impersonator, though it sounds like he's channeling a bit of Torgo, too. I only included in this video as a reminder to Valve that they thought this was good enough to be packaged with their number one multiplayer mod.
I almost didn't include this one because I didn't think it could be found anywhere besides the Counter-Strike retail disc anymore, and these things are impossible to find since stores don't like to carry used and old PC games. Eventually, I discovered it was available on ModDB under the name Absolute Redemption. Just make sure you download the Steam-compatible version. Funny enough, it was the Counter-Strike jewel case that reminded me of another mod that Valve was involved in. See, on the back of the CD case, there's...
Well, here we are again. It's always...
Hello?
You will not mention that game, Mr. Strife.
Well, why not? I mean, it's technically not a mod anymore, but it tangents perfectly with my theme of Valve getting involved with the user community to create content with the Half-Life engine.
My employers do not consider it to be within the sphere of the Half-Life universe, and thus it is not relevant. You will not mention the game, you will not show any footage of the game, and if you so much as say the title, I will have your room materialize in the center of the sun. Do I make myself... clear?
Yes, my tallest.
What?
Nothing, just a little inside joke. Can I at least still do the zombie mod?
Proceed.
Thank you, dick. So yeah, zombies. Remember I brought up Brain Bread in the last video as an example of how people love to make zombie-related mods? Well, at the time, there was no mod out there that captured the pure essence of zombie survival horror quite like They Hunger by Black Widow Games.
A little backstory first. Neil Mankey was a level maker from British Columbia that caught the eye of PC Gamer magazine, who commissioned him to create a few Quake 2 mods based around their mascot, Coconut Monkey. These were included on the PC Gamer CDs you got if you paid extra or had a subscription, and were a nice little bonus for the fans. Mankey had a good flair for level design, action, and pacing, and when Half-Life came out, he jumped at the chance to play with a new toolset. At this point, Mankey was working with a team dubbed Black Widow Games, and created another mod for PC Gamer titled USS Darkstar. Another here's what I think happened to Gordon after Half-Life story. Gordon is assigned to a deep space zoological research ship where things once again go bad and the aliens break loose. Darkstar is still a decent level pack, but I don't feel like it's aged well. The levels are confusing, blocky, and claustrophobic, which does help with the overall dark and creepy mood it's going for, but it isn't very aesthetically appealing anymore. Some of the puzzles are annoying, and there's a lot of low-gravity jumping puzzles in the second half. It's still enjoyable for a more even-paced survival horror kind of feel. There are some nice memorable set pieces, including a scene where a teleporter mishap shrinks you down a la classic Duke Nukem, and you climb into a nearby security computer to disable it from the inside. It was also set up with a cliffhanger ending with no sequel planned, so be prepared for that. Another word of warning, there hasn't been an update to this mod for over a decade, so getting it to run on a Steam copy of Half-Life can be tricky. So while I still give this one a recommendation and would encourage you to seek it out, I feel like it was just practice for their next mod.
6 months later, with the sponsoring of PC Gamer magazine, Black Widow Games would release what is still considered to be the magnum opus of the Half-Life modding community, They Hunger.
The story follows a writer traveling into the countryside, wherever that is. We open on a shot of BMRF radio. I see what you did there. The local DJ interrupts a show of oddly Indian-sounding background music to report unknown atmospheric phenomena and electrical displays.
Okay, bit of a rant here, but there is just something that bothers me as someone who has worked in broadcasting about people who don't know anything about broadcasting writing stuff like this.
First of all, this story can be summed up as, we saw lightning, but there's no thunderstorm. That's not something worth interrupting a show over. Second, if it's an important news bulletin, you turn off the background music. When the weatherman on TV is warning you about an approaching tornado, he doesn't have friends playing behind him on the weather map. Third, and this is really just a nitpick here, no matter how rundown your radio station is, you don't put your microphone near an open window. My computer's 3 feet away from this microphone, and it's hard enough keeping the sound of its fans off the audio track, never mind the sound of giant crickets outside.
Okay, rant over. Sorry about that, I just had to get that off my chest. Then I felt like I was channeling Diamanda Hagen for a second there. Just be glad you didn't see me after I saw the Hunger Games.
Anyway, the player gets stranded in the middle of nowhere when a freak lightning strike destroys their car. After emerging in a sewer adjoining the world's worst mausoleum, you come to a mortuary just in time to hear the radio report of mysterious attacks, just as the dead start to rise, hungry for flesh. Luckily, someone dropped a brass-handled umbrella for you to use as a melee weapon.
Because when all else fails, umbrella?
So you manage to beat back the zombies and flee back into the catacombs and then the surrounding woods. A little hiking later and you come across a dying villager who tells you to try and make it into town and use the radio station to call for help, as thanks to classic horror movie tropes, all the phone lines are down. He also warns you that all the local police have been turned as well. Although his warning about the police might have been more useful if he told me they were zombies that still knew how to use guns, helicopters, and turrets, I guess that little detail must have slipped his mind. Anyway, after trudging through some swamps and narrowly avoiding making out with the front of a train, you hijack the train engine, make your way to the radio station in town, and call the authorities for help. Predictably, they don't believe you.
Hey, I already told you we will investigate. Now stop insisting. If you believe you're in danger, go to the nearest police station and wait for us there. Over and out.
So since you're a good little protagonist who can only follow directions from others, you decide to check out the police station, after hijacking a cop car for a short joyride, of course. And even though you're armed to the teeth at this point, instead of bursting in the front door Terminator style, you try and sneak in the back. Before you can say cornhold, you're knocked out by the fat zombie sheriff and thrown in a cell, as the zombie cops start to execute their prisoners one by one.
Well, short game, guess I'm Oh, right. See, when They Hunger first came out, it was originally released in 3 installments. Episode 1 ended there, and we had to wait about 6 months before the next installment. It's a little frustrating, but I guess it's better than waiting an entire year for the next episode. Or 5 years.
So how does this cliffhanger conclude?
With heavy ordnance!
Oh yeah!
Get the hell out of there before they catch you!
Yes, apparently there was one cop with enough brains to avoid getting zombified and found the best way to defend himself was with a truck-mounted rocket launcher.
This nameless NPC is now my hero. Though I have to ask if rocket launchers are standard issue at rural police stations. Then again, the sheriff is Southern.
So you venture through what's left of town, abandoning your savior along the way, I might add, and dive into the sewers for a while. Eventually you end up on the outskirts of the town's insane asylum, where you catch Sheriff Rockwood having a chat with a Dr. Franklin, expressing concern over your interference and how they'll have more allies soon after just a few more experiments. You know, stereotypical C-grade villain stuff. Now that you finally have an enemy, you try to follow them and break into the asylum, searching for clues in the doctor's home. This is probably the coolest part of this whole mod. This place just drips with atmosphere because, at first, there are no enemies. The place is empty, devoid of monsters or zombies or anything except a few reel-to-reel audio logs. When you finally have enough backstory, you— OH SHIT!
Yeah, see, when I played this for the first time, this whole section left me feeling really on edge and nervous. So when I turned around and saw an NPC just standing there, I kinda panicked.
I'll show you.
So the doctor's assistant Alfred shows up and gets you into the doctor's lab, hoping you'll stop him while giving a little backstory.
It's something that can bring anyone alive or dead to some intermediate state of half-life. But after that, Dr. Franklin started to act strangely.
Franklin's lab is pretty messed up. Living heads in a tank, Bruce Campbell's severed evil hand, a screaming guy on a meat hook, all that good stuff. Oh, and the lab looks like this at the bottom of a shaft built in a natural cave.
If you're a construction worker or a contractor and you're ever hired to build something like this,
you should call the police!
You arrive too late to stop Dr. Franklin, but his new Franklinsteins don't seem too happy with him either. In the ensuing chaos, you fight your way through the asylum and the zombified security guards, only to end up trapped in a basement with a giant boiler. If you've seen an episode of Mythbusters involving hot water heater cannons, you'll know how you escape. Only problem is, you end up setting the place on fire in the process, so now you have extra incentive to flee. But torching the villain's hideout and escaping with a happy ending would be too easy, so you end up trapped again, forced to turn a giant fuel storage tank into a makeshift explosive, while you're standing about 15 feet away from it.
Wake up, you're having a nightmare. Honey?
And that's how episode 2 ended, with the sun black screen and the voiceover implying this had all been some kind of crazy nightmare. I guess they weren't sure a PC gamer would approve in episode 3, but they did. Basically making this scene the equivalent of the following Monty Python bit.
So, it was all a dream.
No, dear. This is the dream. You're still in the cell.
Episode 3 begins with a nightmare of Dr. Franklin's ghost taunting you, then waking up in a hospital. How you actually got to a hospital in a town that's been overtaken by zombies is never really answered. After another nightmare that just seems to be weirdness for the sake of weirdness, you wake up again to find the hospital empty, and not in the best of shape. Like the Asylum Manor level in the last episode, this is a great piece of mood building that hits its climax when you think you've found a nurse in the maternity ward. All seems normal until... right there. That's when you know for sure you're screwed. You escape from the hospital, taking another detour through the sewers and waterways until you come upon a farm. Well, bad things never happen on farms in horror games, I'm sure this place will be fine. Oh, except for the zombie farmers, zombie chickens, and the goddamn zombie bulls. Good thing the game gives you a flamethrower before this happens. Who wants medium-rare tainted brisket? Eventually you end up back at the asylum, which looks a little worse for wear after your little arson episode. And then you stumble into a trap laid by the sheriff, but what else were you supposed to do? Ignore that flamethrower just sitting there? Blasphemy, I say! So the sheriff hauls you out to some kind of zombie gathering, giving a big speech about the evils of the living and satiating their hunger, though I don't quite see the point of a moron giving a hate speech to a brain-dead crowd. Thankfully, the military finally decides to do something and breaks up this Tea Party rally from hell. They don't really succeed, but they do help set you free, so I guess it's a wash. So you escape again and backtrack through the woods, again, except they're more heavily infested now. And the military seems to be working under the same rules from Half-Life, which means they're fine with shooting up civilians. More shooting and escaping later, you encounter something new, a survivor! The town's missing deputy suddenly appears and asks for your help getting to a helicopter so you can fly out of the infected town and pass the military quarantine. At least, I think that's the plan. He's kind of muffled by that bulletproof glass. There's some backtracking through the asylum ruins, then you come across the sheriff and Dr. Franklin again, who's gotten over his whole being blown up problem by turning into a cyborg. Like you do. You and the deputy hijack a police chopper and make a getaway, gunning down Cyber Franklin and then the sheriff in a pretty awesome helicopter fight before limping off into the sunset. So yes, you do shoot the sheriff, but you don't shoot the deputy.
Boo!
So that's the end of They Hunger. What do I really think of it? Well, it's flawed, but it definitely stands out as a gem among the modding community.
You can see a definite progression in quality between the three chapters, and it's more than a little reminiscent of the Evil Dead trilogy progression. Episode 1 feels unrefined, but atmospheric. Episode 2 ramps up the action, but still delivers the best setting, atmosphere, and tension. Episode 3 goes a little overboard, showing a lot of work and polish with some great action set pieces, but at the detriment of the story and horror. You can also tell the series was episodic because of how much gets added over the course of the game. The standard zombies start off with only a few different skins, but eventually become a lot more varied and even have varying levels of speed and strength as the game progresses. Your weapon loadout in Episode 1 is kind of light, then by Episode 3 you're carrying a small arsenal that includes a flamethrower and a chain gun. Most of the content of They Hunger is built on existing models of monsters, weapons, and such, but just about everything is tweaked or altered in some way. For instance, the attack dogs are based on the Hound Eyes, but their sonic attack is gone and replaced with a melee bite. Most of the weapons are reskins of the Half-Life arsenal, but a few weapons are imported from Team Fortress Classic, and a couple are brand new, like the Tech 9, which was designed for the game by Min Lee Guzman, creator of Counter-Strike. Also, there's something very satisfying about beating a zombie back into its grave with a shovel. Of course, not everything works perfectly. While the electroskeletons are a nice, creepy addition at first, their sound effects give them away before you see them, and they keep talking even after they've been killed. Not all the models look great, especially the sheriff. Something about him just looks off.
Why is his head so big? Why is his head so big?
The early levels are pretty rough and blocky, though I admit the Half-Life engine wasn't really designed to build realistic outdoor levels. Some of the environments are pretty goofy too, like why does this remote town have an active volcanic fissure complete with a sea of lava? If you're hoping to see more They Hunger and Black Widow games, you might be out of luck. Mankey's team has been pretty quiet for the last few years. Back in 2005, they relaunched their website with an announcement revealing They Hunger, Lost Souls, a zombie game using the Source Engine for retail release. PC Gamer and Planet Half-Life ran big previews of the game, but things apparently went downhill after that. Despite a number of screenshots, promos, and a release date of 2008, there hasn't been any news in over 4 years.
Overall, I would still call They Hunger a must-play for any Half-Life owner, especially if you're into zombie horror games. While it's definitely flawed and not as impressive thanks to the passage of time, it still stands as a high watermark for the modding community in terms of design and creativity. Plus, it's free, and if you can get into it, it might give you a few scares. Well, I think that's enough of Half-Life 1, so next time, we're going after the big one, the one you've all been waiting for. So I'm Dax, and I'll see you later.
Yeah.
nameless NPC is now my hero. Though, I have to ask if rocket launchers are standard or...